5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. They would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sure.
Deal.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jeffy. Let's start the show. This episode is brought to you by Audible.com. Go to audibletrial.com/Bigfoot Hotspot for your first free downloadable book and your first free 30-day trial. I'm telling you, man, I feel like I've been in a car accident.
that kind of work will do it to you, man. I'm telling you.
Yeah, I've been lifting those 150-pound beams up all week on this construction site. I was in a motorcycle accident probably 5 years ago,
oh,
6 years ago, something like that. I don't think I physically hurt being in a motorcycle accident than I do right now. Getting too old for this stuff, man.
I hear you, man. Getting old for that kind of stuff, but we're still out hunting monsters.
Yeah, yeah. On a positive note, a girl that was probably, God, she couldn't have been more than 22, gave me her number, or tried to give me her number.
Uh-oh.
But, yeah, you know, we're all the 22-year-old girls when I was 22, you know what I mean?
Well, you know, they're never interested in you when you're the right age to take advantage of that. You know, it's always when you're old that they all want you, and you want nothing to do with them at that point. Well, you might, I mean, but, you know, I'm kind of over the hill, so.
Yeah, yeah, 22 is still 22, you know.
This is true.
Yeah, it just made me laugh. I was just like, really?
That's funny.
Yeah. So what have you been up to?
Well, wading through emails.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, man, it's the one nice thing I like about with the guests or with all of our listeners is we get a lot of really great messages from folks out there and lots of really good accounts coming in. I guess should we talk about the one funny one this week, the YouTube video with the Russian newscaster?
Yeah, I was laughing when I saw that, man.
I don't even know where to begin to describe that one. I mean, we're going to have to post it up on the fan page on Facebook because it's really hilarious. I mean, if you want a good laugh, folks, you got to go there and click on it. It's only about 4 minutes long, but it's just funny as hell.
Yeah, it's funny when you get wrapped up in this whole Bigfoot business. I guess you kind of become numb to a lot of things. And watching the newscaster go through the different people of the Bigfoot world and kind of what's going on. It's really laughable. It's like she said, you know, you can't make this stuff up. I was busting up. I was just like, to actually hear it from kind of an outsider and have her go through the different people, I was like, wow, this really is a circus.
Sometimes you really have to get that sort of view from outside the whole subject to see what, you know, what people across the world and other places are, or how they view what's going on here. I laughed my tail up. I thought that was hilarious. It was funnier, or as funny, if not funnier, than, you know, the guys we talked about last week.
Yeah. It was funny to watch her reaction, how she couldn't hold the straight face. She's busting up. I mean, I'll post it up on Facebook. I'll find the link and post it up. It is good for a good laugh, you know?
Oh, yeah. Like I said, I wouldn't even know how to begin to describe it. You just have to go there and watch it, and it's well worth going and checking out.
Yeah, it's hilarious. It really is.
Okay, our first guest here is Johnny from Ohio. What's interesting about Johnny's story is that he has some information about one of the type 3s, or what is commonly referred to as the Dogman type creatures, and we don't get very much of that yet, so it's something new that we're looking into, and I think Johnny will be an interesting guest. Usually what I do is when I talk to somebody about their encounter is just try to get a little bit of background, you know, by starting off asking things like, now before the incident, you know, what kind of knowledge did you have of the subject of Bigfoot?
I'd watched stuff on TV about it, you know, all kinds of, like, Monster Quest, stuff like that. And what originally got me started in it was, way back in the day, Unsolved Mysteries, the old school one, on TV, and they showed a bunch of stuff on it, and it scared me to death, like, when I was really young. And my mom wanted to show me that it wasn't something to be afraid of or anything like that. So she took me to the library, and we read, like, all the books, all kinds of VHS tapes on it and stuff like that to show me that it wasn't something to be scared of. Yeah, pretty much after that, you know, I just would watch stuff on it whenever I got a chance.
Okay. Now, what part of the country is this?
Ohio.
Ohio, okay.
Yeah.
So, okay, let's go forward then to your encounter. Can you tell us what you were doing prior to leading up to this?
Pretty much me, my girlfriend at the time, and two of her friends, we were just kind of out driving around because we had nothing really better to do. And we'd just go and drive for hours on end and pretty much try and get lost. That and we were underage, and we would go out and drink a little bit and stuff like that and just hang out. We had just pulled off in this little gravel turnaround, or this little gravel, it was around a curve, and there was a, like a gravel section off to the side of the road, off to the left, probably wide enough for a car and a half, like maybe a breakdown lane. So we park, I'll get out, and we're playing the radio on the car, and just kind of hanging out. It started getting dark, and off to our left, there was a huge honeysuckle bush. I mean, this thing was the biggest honeysuckle bush I've ever seen, and it was right on the edge of a wood line. And as we were kind of hanging out and talking, kept hearing stuff like branches breaking, stuff like that. And we thought it was maybe, you know, an animal like a raccoon or something like that. It started getting louder and louder. After, you know, like that night, I didn't drink anything because, one, I don't like vodka. And they had just finished off drinking the vodka. The one guy that drove wanted to scare it off by throwing the bottle into the honeysuckle bush. So as he threw it in there, he threw it into the bushes, and the sound stopped. So we kind of shrugged it off, and within a minute or two, that bottle comes flying back and lands into the road. So it goes past us into the road, and this scares us all to death because we're out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, there's no lights. I don't even remember the last house we saw. And so we all freak out and run, jump back in the car, and we go the opposite way we came. And we must have been driving for maybe 2 or 3 minutes, and we had to stop because there's a huge, well, not really a huge, there's a pretty large branch laying in the road. Me and him jump out to go move it. And by that time it was already dark, so the headlights were on and everything. So we run out, or I get out, he gets out, we run over to move this thing, and we could barely move it. Like, we ended up having to spin it rather than pick it up and throw it off to the side of the road. it was too heavy for us both, and for us to try and actually lift up and, like, pick up and move. And while we're doing that, this really horrible smell comes, like, comes waving in because the wind started blowing, and it smelled like some, like, garbage, or, like, a wet dog and garbage, and, like, a mix of, like, rotting meat and that. And with that, as we're doing that, we hear movement pretty much, like, all around us, and it wasn't little cracks from the wind blowing in the trees. It was large snaps of branches all around. And so once we get the branch spun enough to where we could get by, because if we would have tried to drive around it, like I said, we wouldn't have made it, because off to the side of the road there was a small ditch. Right. And if we would have tried to drive in that car, it would have got stuck. The interesting thing about that was I wasn't on the end where it was broke off at. There was no way a branch of that size would have broke and fell into the road, because there was no tree canopy over top of the road. It was cut back. Maybe after we move it, we run and jump back in the car, and we just take off. After that, we never really went back to the air for a while.
So you got another encounter after that?
Yeah, we did. How long after that one?
Yeah.
I would say probably a couple years. Because okay. me and that girl at the time were together for about 3 or 4 years. This one I actually did see something, and I still kind of doubt myself on what exactly I saw, because it's just one of the things where, in my mind, it's like, what? This doesn't happen to me. You know, it happens to, I always hear about it happening to other people, and I had no idea. You know, I didn't know that something like that existed in Ohio. Like, I heard of the Perry County grass man and stuff like that, but I always thought it was an old kind of settler's tale, like that one, like the one where the guy got attacked by something in the 1800s, I think, and his daughter fought it off with a rock or something like that. Like, I figured it was one of those tales, like an older tale. The one that I saw personally was me and the same girl, we were driving around again. We're driving on the backcountry road again. And as we're driving, the sun's setting behind us. And it was probably beyond dusk, because we had just turned the headlights on. And we had just got done coming around a curve. I want to say does, but it was about springtime, maybe early summer. Two deer run out in the road, and they act like we're not even there. So she jams on the brakes, and I'm in the passenger seat, and she comes to a stop, and so I was like, man, that was close. And she goes, yeah. And I just happened for some reason to look up in the rearview mirror to see if there's any more deer coming. When I do, I see, and this is exactly what I saw, I see something taking one big step into the road, like a mid-step, and it lands on its right leg. From what I'm seeing in the rear view, I'm seeing from about mid to thigh up to its stomach. And then I watched it swing its left leg, or its right leg forward, and as it steps, it puts hand down on the back, on the trunk of the car. Like, not pressing down on it, but just kind of pushing its hand, put its hand on it, kind of like when you don't want to run into something where it's like a low... Yeah, so it caught itself so it wouldn't hit it. And even though the sun was behind us, it was still getting really dark, I was able to see this because of the taillights. And so everything was red. And I kind of blinked, it seems like it took forever in my mind, but I blinked, and I looked over at her, and she's wide-eyed, and she's white, and her mouth is open, and I see her eyes tearing up. So I look back, and it's, you know, already going across the road. So I turn around, I'm like, and again, in my head, I was like, what did I just see? So I open the door and step out, but leave the door open. And on the other side of the road, this would be to my right, it went down a little embankment right into the woods. And I see something probably from the armpits up, or at least that's where I focused on, from the armpits up. And its shoulders were really wide, and it was black or dark brown. From the last little bit of light that was coming off, you know, because the sun was setting, I could see it had ears on top of its head, like a dog. And from what I could see from the ears, they were real thin, not really wide, not really that fuzzy. And its general head and shape of its head was kind of dome shaped, more or less. Like it looked like its sides were kind of flat, and the top of its head was just slightly rounded or flat. But it acted like we weren't even there. It just kept going.
Yeah. Do you think it knew you were there?
I think it knew us that we were there, but it was kind of too focused on the deer.
So, Johnny, was this more of a dog? More of a, what they call, like, a dog?
I believe so. That's what I've always chalked it up as.
Was the body, did it look more primate or more human-like in appearance, besides the head, of course?
It honestly reminded me of thinner, it was definitely thinner. Like, everything I think of when I think of Bigfoot or Sasquatch, I think of the Patty film, and the big broad shoulders and the not compact, but just really stocky and built. And
yeah.
But these ones, in my opinion, and what I saw from it was not as wide as Patty looked, but it was definitely probably about 1.5 times my shoulders. And, you know, I have pretty broad shoulders, so it was at least 1.5 times my width. And I remember the leg was, it's probably a good, probably 6 inches bigger, round as mine.
What did you think when you saw it?
What the hell did I just see? Because it was way too big to be a person.
Right.
And there's nobody that, what did I just see? Unless there's some 7-foot dude running around with a ghillie suit on at 8:30 at night.
What was going through your mind? And I know we got a few other guests we have to get to, and I really do appreciate you sharing your encounter. I appreciate you sharing it. I wanted to know, what was going through your mind when you you guys tossed the vodka bottle out the first time, and then to have it come throwing back through the air? What was going through your mind? Were you think? I mean,
to be completely honest, at first I thought like somebody was kind of playing a joke, you know.
Yeah.
But then it dawned on us that nobody was around at all. Like I said, I don't even remember the last time we passed a house or anything. Because after it got thrown, you know, it just got dead quiet. There was no more branches breaking, no nothing. It just didn't feel right. It was, once I flew back, it was like, we gotta get out of here. I don't want to know what threw the bottle back, because no animal in the woods here in Ohio will throw a bottle back.
Yeah, I think I'd be a little worried about that, too.
Yeah. The thing is, it could have hit us, because it flew past us and landed in the road. So if it really wanted to hit us with that bottle, it definitely could have.
I was interested, when you saw the creature, you mentioned the ears. Did you get a chance to see any of the face at all? I mean, the shape in particular.
No, I didn't. I saw in the rear view, I saw it from about mid-leg to stomach, and then by the time I got out of the car, it was already off to the side of the road, and all I got to see was the back of its shoulders and the back of its head.
Okay. I was just wondering, you know, we get, like Wes said, there's not a whole lot known about these Type 3 creatures, and oftentimes people will describe them as having a snout, you know.
Yeah.
Almost like a dog. And I tend to think that with primates, you know, of course, many primates have a protruding lower face. So Yeah. They might be mistaken, you know, for a dog appearance, but the ears are kind of a tip-off in this case.
That's what made me think of a werewolf, pretty much, basically, the whole time, like a wolf mare,
right,
stuff like that. Not really hearsay stories, but ones that, like, me and my friends who grew up around that area, that they'd talk about their cars being paced by something off to the side, and they'd be going about maybe 35, 40 down these back roads, and something would be pacing their car. And the most interesting one for me is one of our friends that I had back in the day, her family raised horses. And when, like, she came to school one day and she was tore up, or she was upset because her horse died. Something happened to it and it died. So that day when we dropped her off, we saw the horse pen, and they had a backhoe, and they were digging a big hole for it, and they were just going to roll it in and bury it. So evidently that day it did. And then that following Monday, she came back to school, and she was real sad again. We're like, "You still sad about your horse?" She goes, "Well, yeah." And we're like, "All right." And she goes, "Something dug it up." And we're like, "What?" Something, according to her, something, after they buried it on that Friday or Saturday, the next day when they went out to feed the rest of the horses, something had dug up that horse and drug it out of the hole, like half out of the hole to where its head was dangling in, and something cored it out, like ate it out, like completely gutted it. But the thing is, I couldn't find any of the guts or anything.
Kumbo talked about that, like when he told me a story one time where someone's dog had died, and they had buried it, and then they got up the next morning, and something had actually dug up the dog, and actually, same thing as you're describing with the horse, basically gutted it in the middle of the night. And so, I mean, it's kind of believable, you know. Kumbo has actually told me a few stories like that, where something has actually dug something up and quartered it out, like, you know, a beloved pet, like a horse or a dog or something like that.
Yeah, I've personally never heard anything like that, and I'm more terrified of what's strong enough to pull a horse up out of a hole.
Yeah, no kidding.
Because we don't have anything big like that around that area.
I thought Bigfoot creeped me out, but Dogman really creeps me out.
Yeah. And I have a question about sorry about that.
No,
I have one final question. In your research, you guys have been doing shows about the government cover-up with that. What would ultimately be the reason why? I mean, Russia, they're openly, more or less seems like they're openly wanting people to talk about it. But it seems more or less the government in the United States is kind of pulling a blanket over everything. Why would you ultimately think that? Why? I mean, I heard you guys speculate on the forestry and stuff like that.
I've actually been in contact with people involved with forestry at various levels, you know, who are government employees, and they agree with my view that, and I'm going to be writing about this in one of my new books, but in a nutshell, it has to do with economics.
Yeah, that's exactly what I thought, because it would take...
Right. Well, with any issue like this, I mean, if you know, it's one thing to have an owl or some smaller species, you know, and the impact that has on forests and surrounding communities and how people use forest products or if they're even able to, depending on, you know, the impact. But if something like a large primate were proven to exist, you know, in the continental U.S., then not only forest. National forest lands, federally governed lands, but even private lands could be theoretically confiscated.
Yeah.
And, you know, people wouldn't be too happy about their property being seized by the government because, you know, the Sasquatch habitat was being studied. You know,
yeah.
I think that would cause a lot of problems. And look what the spotted owl did to logging communities in the Pacific Northwest. I mean, it really trashed those communities' economic systems. And they never recovered from that. So it would be a big deal. And I think if we follow the money in that case, that's going to lead us to those answers.
Yeah. So that's what I was thinking, too. I mean, just imagine the social and economic impact of finding out that there's more than one thing that walks on two legs now. You know, I mean, all the things everybody's brought up, thinking, saying that, you know, man is, you know, top of the food chain, we're the smartest because of reason X, Y, and Z, you know, we walk bipedally, which means, you know, we're the top of the food chain type thing. And it would, I think, in my mind, it would just turn around and just bring it all crashing down.
Yeah, a lot of people think it's just logging, but you got to think of the ripple effect beyond logging, billions and billions of dollars.
Oh, well.
Well, I don't know if I have any questions for Johnny. Do you have any further questions? Well, I really appreciate coming on, Johnny. I mean,
well,
it was cool.
No, we covered it. We sure
thank you for listening to me.
Yeah, we sure appreciate you sharing your incidents with us.
Yeah, absolutely.
No, thank you, guys. You know, I found your guys' podcast at the beginning of the year, and I've listened to everything just because I was bored one day looking for different podcasts, and your guys just happened to pop up, and I love it. I think you guys are kind of my go-to guys when it comes to any of this stuff, and I know you guys don't claim to be experts, but you guys are the most professional-sounding ones I've heard so far, and to me, that is an expert. So,
I appreciate that.
We certainly do.
Everyone here at Bigfoot Hotspot Radio would like to thank Audible.com. Audible.com is the internet leading provider of audiobooks with over 150,000 different titles to choose from. To download a free audiobook of your choice, go to audibletrial.com/Bigfoot Hotspot.
How are you?
I'm very good. How are you this evening?
Oh, I can't complain.
Wes is on the line here with us.
Hey, Phil.
Awesome. Hey, Wes, how are you? I'm doing well, thanks. How are you doing this evening? That's good.
Yeah, I'm doing all right. Doing all right. Thanks for coming on the show. Appreciate it.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Now, usually what I do is, with everybody, is we'll just kind of give a little background. I like to always know what people knew about the subject of Bigfoot before they had any sort of an encounter.
Yeah.
So if you could just tell us what you knew prior to what your experience was, or, you know, thoughts and experiences there, that would be great.
Yeah. So growing up, you know, my mom was kind of instrumental in my introduction to Bigfoot and Sasquatch and everything. You know, every time there was a special on the History Channel, she would watch it. And, you know, of course, being a little kid, I'd be so enthralled by the idea of, you know, this monster living in the woods or something like that. You know, the biggest thing for me growing up was understanding more so what it was and its actions. And the more that I grew older, the more I realized that, you know, they weren't necessarily these big, large, docile creatures, you know. Because that's how, when I was growing up on TV, that they were portrayed, you know. You'd always see the Patty footage where they were, you know, it was running away and it was scared, you know. And it's, from my encounters, it's the complete opposite effect, you know. They're more assertive and they want to be more dominant, you know. But, you know, just overall, you know, growing up, you know, like I said, you have the television shows put them on as these far-cyclic, you know, creatures that are going to be big and docile, and you can go pet them, or, you know, they aren't going to harm you or anything like that, which I couldn't buy that in a million years after my two encounters, you know?
Okay, well, so let's fast forward then to the first time you had an encounter. What were you doing that led up to that incident?
Yeah, so the first time I had an encounter, my buddy and I were fishing on a river in a small town near where I live. I live in Twinsburg, Ohio, and we were fishing, you know, kind of an out of the way branch of a river called the Chagrin River by us. And, you know, it's kind of far back in the woods, like kind of in this gorge with a bunch of hemlocks and pine trees and maple trees and all that good stuff. But we'd been, you know, just fishing throughout the course of the day and, you know, just kind of having a blast, you know, throwing rocks and raising all kinds of hell, you know, being, you know, just fresh out of high school and all that good stuff. The one thing about this river that is not really known about it is that when it floods in the you know, early spring, when we have all the snow melt and runoff and everything, is it creates like these little chutes. You know, typically like a river will flood and you'll have these big floodplains. Well, there's this little island that seems to sit there. And there was like this little chute that we would always cut through when we would, you know, walk or, you know, go fishing. And so this one time I had, this particular time that we went, I was feeling, you know, kind of uneasy about the whole thing, you know. But I said, you know, there's nothing there. I'm just not going to pay any attention to it. And we started to cut through this little offshoot. And all of a sudden I started to smell like a rotten, musky urine smell. You know, so I didn't think twice about it, but I said to my buddy, I said, hey, do you smell that? And he says, yeah, you probably are so excited about catching all these fish, you probably, you know, peed all over yourself. And, you know, we're kind of getting back and forth to each other, but we didn't really think about it. So we crossed back over the river and we started to hike and fish our way upstream again. And that took us probably about 2 or 3 hours, and we made it to kind of like these set of falls. There's three sets of falls. The first two are easy, you know, to get over. The last set is probably about 20 or so feet high that kind of dead ends in a town. You know, all the tourists like to go and look at it and take pictures of it and all that stuff like that. So when we got there, you know, instead of cutting back through town, which would have been, in my idea, you know, the better solution, you know, he wanted to fish his way back down and try and catch, you know, some more fish that we had missed. So we started fishing our way back down, and we're getting to the portion where we cross over the river. You know, we're probably about, oh, I'd say 1,500 feet or so from where we cross the river. And all of a sudden I start hearing, you know, like a shuffling in the leaves, you know. And I kind of look over and don't really think anything of it. And so we start walking a little bit more, and I start to hear, instead of the shuffling, footsteps. And again, I stop and don't really think anything of it, you know, just kind of talking, thinking, oh, it's probably a deer or something like that. And so we get to about 100 feet away from where we cross, and all of a sudden I get this really uneasy feeling that something is there. It's kind of like you're being hunted almost. And so I heard the footsteps again, and this time it was mixed with shuffling. I snapped my head real quick to the right, and I didn't catch, you know, it was like the famous picture of the blob squatches that you always see, you know. I saw that in my eye, and I heard, and I immediately froze, and he took off across the river. But I froze, and I myself, you know, being raised in the outdoors, I thought it was a bear, so I wanted to try and keep my eyes on whatever was out there. So I turned my back and I started to backpedal towards the river, you know, very slowly, not really trying to raise my, you know, blood pressure or anything like that, or get too nervous. Because, you know, obviously if it's a bear, it's going to chase you. Once I heard that noise and started backpedaling, I didn't really see anything else, but I definitely got the idea that I wasn't wanted there. You know, whatever it was, it was very angry. You know, it was such a deep guttural growl. It was so primeval that I couldn't, it still bothers me to kind of think about it. You know, I get a little bit shaky talking about it. And it's really disturbing to the point where I get, you know, I can feel the vibrations in my chest. You know, I can still feel those vibrations in my chest from that growl that I heard.
That's you know, it's what I've experienced.
Yeah, I've listened a lot. I've heard Les's stories all over the place, and you know, every time he describes it, like I get that feeling that oh my god, you know, I'm reliving this again. You know.
Yeah. No, I understand. You feel it in your chest. I mean, I know exactly what you mean when you say that. And you do. You really.
And you know, a lot of people. Oh yeah, and the thing a lot of people don't and. Because so many people haven't experienced it, but the best way I can equate it to a lot of people is if you get in your car and you find a rap song that has the heaviest bass on it, you turn your bass all the way up in your car, and that still doesn't touch what it feels like in your chest. You know?
Yeah.
So, you know, I backpedaled towards the river. Once I hit that, once I felt the gravel beneath my feet, I turned my back and I started walking. You know, trying not to panic or anything. And by that time, my buddy was all the way up the river, and he was standing on the road over the bridge waiting for me. You know? But that was definitely...
What a jerk.
What was that?
I said, what a jerk. He's not backing you up. He's taking off.
Oh, no. He grew up a lot. He grew up in Chicago, so he doesn't... He hasn't spent as much time in the woods as I have. You know, his first instinct for everything is to run, you know. I myself understand if it's a bear, I got to keep my eyes on it because it's going to want to kill me if I start to run.
Yeah. No, I was just playing with you. I was rude. I didn't mean to cut you off. Go ahead.
I'm not. It doesn't insult me. It'll probably get him a little bit. but yeah, you know, that was my first experience, and that was, you know, for me, kind of disturbing because the area that we live in is a fairly well-populated area. You know, I mean, it's not like it's in the back of beyond, but it's also not city as well, you know. But, yeah, that was relatively disturbing for me. I still have problems going to that section of river, and, in fact, I won't fish where we cross. I won't fish past that point. You know, it's got some kind of juju on that ground for me.
I don't blame you. So you didn't actually see it then. You just heard the growl and you heard the vocalizations and...
Yes.
Yeah. No, yeah. When you hear the vocalizations, though, I mean, it's one of those things to where it can't really... Like the growl we heard, how you described it with the bass and everything. I mean, you can't... It's hard to pinpoint what else it could be. You know what I mean?
That it's a Sasquatch, but, you know, what else could make a noise like that?
Right, exactly.
Yeah, that's my exact thoughts, because I've actually got a buddy who works for the Division of Natural Resources out here, and he played me some bear calls, and he was, you know, some, like, bear noises and all that stuff, and he said, is this what you heard? And I said, definitely not what I heard. That time's about 10, you know?
Yeah.
And he was like, well, there's nothing in this area that I know of that does that.
And you're in Ohio, aren't you, Philip?
Yes.
Yeah, so, I mean, what do you guys have out there, black bear?
We have, so down where we had that incident, there are actually no bears that live in that area anymore. Now, up where I live, up in Twinsburg and, you know, towards this area of town, they come right through here on their way over to Pennsylvania. You know, we're kind of like the bear highway through Twinsburg, but through Chagrin, there's nothing as far as bears go anymore there. Historically, there have been, but nowadays, no more.
Yeah. Yeah, and usually bears don't have that growl that you're describing.
No, as far as I've heard, no.
Yeah. So what happened on your second encounter?
So the second encounter actually happened, it's going to be about 2 years ago this September. My now fiance, she came out from L.A. to Ohio for my birthday, and we went down to Hocking Hills, which is about 45 minutes south of Columbus, which is, it's pretty close to Salt Fork, if you guys are familiar with that area. And this one kind of disturbs me a lot more because I kind of go into protector mode on this one. And what had happened is we got there on a Thursday night, into this campground out just out in Hocking Hills National Forest or National Park or whatever they want to call it. And I chose a camp spot that I had camped at a few times, and it's pretty far back from the main trailhead. You know, it's probably about a mile and a half back of really easy walking, but it's really densely wooded. You know, a lot of people will take they'll pull wagons and everything like that to bring all their camping equipment and stuff back. But we just took, you know, a couple backpacks in with a tent and sleeping bags and stuff. So the night that I had this particular encounter was that Thursday night that we had arrived. And there was, you know, other than the people at the main trailhead who were basically car camping, there was no one to be seen within this, you know, within this area of campground. And so it was about 10:15, I went to bed, my fiance had gone to bed, and I was getting ready to put out the fire, and I put it out and everything, and it was an oddly quiet night. You know, you didn't hear, like, grasshoppers, you didn't hear, like, squirrels thrashing around or anything like that. And it didn't really, you know, at the time, it didn't make much sense to me. I was like, well, I know it's September, and, you know, animals are probably getting ready to hibernate or whatever, but it is what it is. So I put the fire out, and I went to, you know, I got in the tent and zipped it up and went to sleep. And I woke up at about 11:15, 11:30 at night, and I could see, because the trees were starting to lose their leaves for the fall, and I woke up, and I was kind of like in a half day's sleep, but I was fully aware of what was going on around me. And I looked straight up, because we didn't have the rain fly on, because there was no rain in the forecast or anything like that. It was really nice out. And I looked up, and, you know, there was this head looking in our tent. And the oddest thing about it was, is that it looked kind of like a football player had a helmet on, where there was no neck. You know, it was a head resting on shoulders, and I could see hair. It wasn't real long hair, but it was really, you know, you could tell by the texture of it, it was crinkly and coarse, and, you know, it was a really, you know, it almost looked like horse hair. It was so thick and crinkly, you know?
It poked its head in the tent? It was over the tent. Oh, okay.
Like it was looking down on top of us.
I got you.
And, you know, I didn't think, Go ahead.
That's not much better, but.
No.
But
no.
Go ahead.
And so, you know, not wanting to panic or, you know, startle my fiance, I kind of just rolled over and pulled the covers over my head, and I said, whatever it is, it's going to go away. And so I fell back asleep, and I woke up about 3:30 then to go to the bathroom. And, you know, I had pretty much forgotten about it. And so I hopped out of the tent, and I walked about maybe 50 feet into the surrounding woods and to the rear of the tent. And going back from there, there was a tree that was about, you know, a full-grown tree. And then there was another tree that was standing next to it that had gotten hit by lightning or something like that. And because it was all black and broken off about, you know, the break-off is about, I'm 6 foot tall, and it came up to my chest where the break-off was. So subtract a foot, so about 5 feet tall. And I'm going to the bathroom, and I'm kind of looking in the woods, and I wiped, you know, how you wipe the coals out of your eyes when you wake up, and I looked up, and I saw this head kind of like bobbing in and out of the tree, kind of like looking at me. And so, you know, I kind of did one of those things where you open your eyes real big, and it put its left hand on the tree and stepped out to behind the half. So it stepped out from the full tree to the half tree. And when it stepped out from behind that full tree and it was standing behind that half tree, like I said, you know, that half tree came up to about my chest. This thing had to have been 6.5 feet tall, you know. And I could clearly, plain as day, see it. You know, with the moonlight shining on it, I could see this thing looking at me. and it wasn't really moving. It had its left hand on the tree, and it was kind of just standing there. I could hear it going, like it was trying to figure out what I was doing, and, you know, because Will and I had been talking via email, and he said, you know, it sounds like he was trying to challenge you. And I myself, you know, I'm a very non-threatening person. You know, I'm about 6 feet tall at the time. I was about 150 pounds of pure skin and bone. You know, I was the least threatening person you could ever run across in the woods, you know. But when I saw that and that, I hopped back in the tent, you know, backpedaled my way, keep an eye on it, backpedaled my way back into the tent and went back in there. The honest thing about it was when I went the next day to look around, you know, that tree area to see, you know, how tall it was, just trying to get a frame of reference. Like I said, that tree came up about mid-chest on me, and I was like, wow, that thing had to have been pretty daggum tall to be as far over it as it was. You know, it had real big, you know, box-like shoulders. You know, it had real big, broad shoulders. Its head was gigantic. You know, it was a lot bigger than I expected it to be, because you see, you know, the Patterson Gimlet, and this I always refer to the Patty footage because it's the most well-known footage, you know. In the video, that head doesn't look very big, but now seeing what I have seen, that head looks absolutely gigantic.
Yeah, people don't really grasp, you know, the dimensions of these things until you're, you know, standing in front of one.
No,
let me ask you this, Philip.
Yeah.
So I'm putting myself in your shoes, and I'm trying to think about, if I'm laying in a tent, and so you're laying up, and you're looking up, and you're seeing this thing looking over, I'm assuming you're seeing, like, the outline of it looking in your tent?
Uh-huh.
What was going through your mind? I mean, how do you go back to sleep after something like that? I mean, you kind of did, like, the 12-year-old, like, I'm going to put the covers over my head, which, I don't blame you, I probably would have done the same thing. But, I mean, how do you go from that to where it's like, well, I got to go out and take a pee now? I mean, were you armed to the teeth or something?
No, I have, honestly, I've never owned a gun in my life. I will never own a gun in my life. You know, all my family members do. And for me, it's just, it's not something that I, you know, I'm not a tree hugger by any means because I spend a lot of time in the outdoors. But at the same time, you know, I don't hunt. I have no reason to own a weapon. You know, the idea that was going through my mind when I was laying there looking at it, oh my God, this thing wants me. But when I kind of rolled over and I laid there for about an hour waiting to go back to sleep or hear anything from it, and I didn't hear anything, you know, I thought at that point, well, whatever it was, if it wanted me, it would have gotten me.
Right.
You know?
And you probably,
you know, nothing is, yeah, you know, you know, 3 millimeters of nylon and a, you know, 10 millimeter sleeping bag aren't going to stop a Sasquatch, you know.
I think the fact that you didn't do anything except basically ignore it kind of diffused the situation. It was, you know, you didn't respond to the challenge.
Mm-hmm.
And you didn't.
And I mean, you know, for me, exactly. You know, I don't. Like I said, I come off as very non-threatening. You know, I engage a lot of people. You know, I it's what I do for a living. You know, I engage people. And I understand, you know, I know how to defuse people, you know. But in that situation, I was like, well, if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. If this thing's going to rip my arm off and beat me at the bloody end, it's going to do that, you know.
Right, you wouldn't have a lot of choice.
Exactly. I wouldn't, whether I had a gun or not, you know, especially from the story, Wes, that you tell. Oh, my gosh. You know, I couldn't. You know, I couldn't imagine being in, you know, having a gun and being in your shoes. I would have been like, well, I guess I'm going to save one round for myself, you know?
And, yeah. You know, holding a gun in your hand, standing in front of one isn't any guarantee either. I mean, my own encounter the first time with two of them, I mean, granted, it was only a 22, but I think had I had my hunting rifle or my 12 gauge, I don't think I would have felt any safer.
Yeah.
No, I mean, big as they are and as intimidating as they are, it's, you know, there should be good reason that people are afraid of them. And for, you know, I always everyone in my family kind of mocks me because I've, you know, told my stories a couple of times, and I don't tell a whole lot of people about them. Yeah. But they're always like, well, I'd shoot it. And I'm like, no, you wouldn't. No, you would not. You know, I understand you guys hunt for deer, and I understand you guys hunt for, you know, whatever else you hunt for. But you see one of these things, you are not, you're going to turn white as a ghost, and you're going to be gripping that gun white knuckle and forget how it works.
Right. It's easy to make those, you know, statements without actually having had that experience. I've heard a lot of people make all kinds of statements, you know, and when you talk to people like the three of us, you know, have all been in that situation to be right in front of one or more. And it's a whole different attitude than people who haven't, and they make all kinds of statements about they would do this or they would do that. Well, you know, they don't know what they would do unless they were in that situation.
Right.
Exactly. You know, for me, it kind of comes down to, you know, the whole, you know, situation of even if you did see something like that, what makes you think that it's not a person in a suit, you know? And would you really want to risk shooting someone? You know,
I think I could tell if it was somebody in a suit. And if I had a rifle in my hands with somebody in a suit, I think I'd scare the crap out of them first and make them get out of that suit and hurry.
Yeah, I think the tables are people.
So, dude, you're somebody in a suit, you better get that zipper in motion quickly.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. For me, especially after what I went through and, you know, listening to your guys' stories countless times, I couldn't, even with a gun, you know, I couldn't imagine doing anything or trying to act on something. You know, it's...
And, you know, we've made it too, that if you did shoot one, I think you'd have a problem where the other ones, it's like, you know, you mentioned the Patterson film. I asked Bob Gimlin once why he and Roger didn't follow that creature. And he said, we were afraid of where the other two were. Because, you know, there were three of them in that situation. They weren't seen, but there were three of them in the area. And one they filmed was the smallest of the three, so they were very concerned about that.
I couldn't imagine being in that. I mean, it's threatening enough when you have one looking at you, but, you know, because now that I think about it, there could have always been, you know, one standing to my left or one standing to my right, and I wouldn't have noticed it because I was so focused on the one directly in front of me.
Exactly.
You know?
That's a common thread in these accounts. And like with Wes and Woody's encounter, you know, there were four of them.
Mm-hmm. Man, I couldn't imagine going through that. And, you know, the more I hear, you know, people who come forward with stories that sound halfway logical, you know, it's a matter of when they see them and they start to follow them, they do feel like they're being led into a trap.
Right, exactly.
You know, I think they kind of...
accounts out there are very logical and they make a great deal of sense.
Yeah. You know, it's...
How far away was the Sasquatch when you were out there peeing? How far away was the Sasquatch from you?
It was about 150 feet away from me. And I... And that's, you know, a rough guess on it. And I was standing... The thing that made me kind of question how big it was and the whole reason why I walked down there was I was standing on an uphill. You know, it was kind of like looking down just a little bit. You know, it had maybe a 2 to 3 degree decline, which, you know, over 150 feet is a pretty substantial, you know, loss of ground. And I walked down there and, you know, I was like, man, that's up there pretty high. And that guy was at least another, you know, foot over me, because it was about, you know, if it was like looking at a human torso, it was about to its, you know, belly button. You know, and like I said, I'm about 6 feet tall. You know? So
yeah, probably talking 7-8 feet.
Yeah.
Yeah. Least. I go 6.5 on the, you know, on the on the shorter side just to make myself feel a little bit better, I think.
Is this, do you ever go back, have you ever gone back to this place?
So I had been, at the time I was 23, I had been camping down at Hocking Hill since I was about 18 years old. You know, and I had always heard the stories of, you know, Bigfoot down here and, you know, you really shouldn't camp by yourself and things like that. But that was the first, you know, incident I had down there. It's an area that I would definitely like to see a little bit more of. And the reason why I say that is because living in, you know, Northeast Ohio around the Twinsburg, Cleveland area, you know, we don't have a lot of instances, you know, incidences. They're further, a lot further east, you know, into Eschtabula County, you know, things like that. You know, and for me, if I'm gonna see it, I kind of want to see a little bit further away from home, so at least I can be sure it's probably not gonna track me home.
That's always a good point.
You know, exactly.
I don't want to bring Bigfoot home.
No, I can't imagine. I can't. It would turn this town upside down. We have a hard enough problem, you know, dealing with Twins Day, let alone Bigfoot.
I think it would redefine not housebroken.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. But we are actually heading over to the Allegheny National Forest in Pennsylvania, and I'm really excited to kind of just sit out after having the experiences that I have had, you know, especially the last one that I had. I'm kind of excited to sit out there and kind of just, you know, soak it all in for a couple of days and see if anything, you know, tries to rear its ugly head. You know, it's definitely this, a lot of this stuff, while it has, you know, made me appreciate the outdoors a lot more and be more aware of the things around me, it's also sparked this whole new interest in me.
I'd say be careful what you wish for.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. You going to go armed next time?
I can't say that I will. You know, it's...
Do you need
I know
again?
It's probably really... What's that?
I said, do you need to borrow a gun?
I probably should. I should probably say yes at this point. You know, again, if I saw it, I'd probably be like, oh, my God, it's going to rip my arm off, you know?
I would say bear mace probably isn't a bad idea.
No, and I actually do have a couple cans of bear mace.
Yeah,
you know, it's something that I do go camping with because...
I mean, because of bears, of course, you know, and any other wildlife that's in the area, but you never know. I mean, if you were in a situation where, you know, the mock charge turned into something a little more aggressive, I think it's probably a good way to defend yourself.
Oh, yeah, you know, like I said, you know, bear mace is something I do carry with me, but I have a few, you know, like they say for bears, you know, it just turns human into a peppery snack, you know?
Go for the
exactly. You know, I'm not. It's something. You know, if I do go armed, that'll be the one thing that I do carry. You know, but it's you know, kind of these whole instances. You know, that the more that I think about them, the more intrigued I get by them. You know, I've kind of been like a sponge the last year or so, trying to soak up all this information and listen to different people's accounts of what has happened to them. And, you know, kind of trying, because, you know, every time you hear a story, you put yourself in that person's shoes and think, right. You know, what would I have done in that situation?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and yeah, then you kind of relate back to your own story.
Yeah, that's a crazy encounter. I wonder if it, you said it was about an hour from the first time you saw it till you went up to go to the bathroom.
The first time I saw it was about 11:30, and then I went to the bathroom at about 3:30 in the morning.
You know, an interesting the fact that you were urinating, and a lot of animals use that to mark territory. So maybe when that creature was watching you do that, and then you just turned around and went back in the tent, you know, maybe that was just enough to sort of establish the boundary there.
Yeah. You know, and it could have been very much one of those things because, you know, like I said, the more I think about it, it's, you know, animals do this all the time. You know, like you said, you know, cats are notorious for it. Dogs are notorious for it.
Right.
Every animal in nature speaks with their pee, you know, because after that night, you know, granted the campground did get a little more filled, but I didn't hear anything. I didn't see anything. You know, I never once felt like I was being watched or anything like that. You know, it was kind of like a one-night occurrence.
Yeah.
Now, that's something, folks, we're not advocating. So if you happen to run into a Sasquatch, don't pee in front of them.
Yeah, I don't recommend it.
Yeah. I can't think of a more non-threatening position to be in.
I couldn't resist that. thing I would have thought to do when I was 16 and standing in front of two of them, you know, I might have wet myself, but I sure wasn't going to, you know, whip it out and pee in front of them.
if I wouldn't have had to have gone, trust me, I wouldn't have been out there. Because I do remember waking up a few times going, man, I really got to go. I can hold it a little bit. I'm going to wait till daylight.
Yeah, I don't blame
you. I just couldn't make it.
Yeah, Mash. That's a good encounter, Philip. I mean, I really do appreciate it. That's a really cool encounter.
Very interesting story.
Has it consumed you yet?
Not 100% consume me. You know, I think, like, 95%.
Yeah.
You know, it's definitely... I think my fiance would agree 100% at this point, because, you know, there's not a night goes by where I don't, you know, have, you know, one of your guys' old, you know, podcast playing, or, you know, some of the other ones that are out there. You know, just like I said, to gain more and more information.
Yeah. Yeah, I tell you, the best way to gain information that I found is listening to people's encounters and listening to, like Will always says, you know, listen to the behavior of what you hear in an encounter. I know John Green talked about that too, and even Renee DeHendon talked about when you hear someone's encounter, the amount of information you can glean from someone's encounter is amazing. When you listen to what they did and then what the Sasquatch did and the whole behavior thing, you know, besides just it walked across the road, when you actually hear the behaviors, you can actually get a lot of information from people's encounters. I'm sure Will.
You really can.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'll give you an example. You know, back in 89, in the Yakult area, Washington, when the family there had their encounter with the Sasquatch, I saw it on the front page of the paper, and I thought, okay, you know, there's probably been a whole horde of people going out there, you know, want to be investigators and everything, but I thought, well, I'll go ahead and check it out anyway. So I drove out there, and sure enough, there had been at least three different groups of people out there to, you know, to question the family, and they were looking for footprints or hair, and that was pretty much it. So when I sat and talked to the people, I listened to their story, and they were talking about when young Nick Goldhammer ran down to the field, and he thought it was a person in the field, and he slipped on a tree branch and fell and made a bunch of noise, and the Sasquatch turned around hearing him to see what was behind it. And he said it got a real surprised look on its face. It kind of reared its head back a little, but then it sort of leaned forward like it was trying to get a better look. And then it put its arms out at 45-degree angles from its body with palms facing him and come walking after him like it was hurting him. And when it got, when he got up and ran to the house and put on some better boots, and, of course, by this time it turned around and was heading back down to the pasture, he went back after it again. Well, it saw him the second time, and this time it wasn't hurting him. It would come running after him, and he climbed up on an outbuilding, and it stood there and waited a while to make sure that he wasn't coming back down. Nick said then it turned around and resumed going the same direction it was going the first time. And I said, well, did any of these other people bother going down there to see where the Sasquatch was going? And he said, no. And I thought that was pretty odd. You know, first time it herded him back, resumed the same course, second time came after him, and then resumed the same course. So I thought, well, there must be some reason it didn't want him going down there. So I asked if we could go look, and we walked across the creek and into another, there was a series of fields there, and I found a big cottonwood tree that had fallen over, and near the root wad of that tree had been a pool of water in the winter, and there was some dried mud there. And I found tracks of two young Sasquatches in that mud all over the place. So I said, well, there's the reason it was trying to keep Nick from going down there. There were two young ones hiding. So
yeah,
when you hear an account, you have to think about what was going on. And you can kind of get the bigger picture when you look at those details.
Yeah, it makes total sense. No, it makes total sense, you know, why it was doing the actions that it was doing, you know.
Exactly. And many people who claim they're investigators never look beyond, you know, what I call the trophies. And I call most of them trophy hunters because they want something tangible. They can run around publicly, you know, with a footprint cast or something like that and say, hey, look at me, I'm an expert, when they didn't pay a lick of attention to what else was happening and why it was happening.
I want to go to a clip of Jeff Meldrum sitting in his bomb shelter holding a footprint cast. I'm just joking. Bad joke. Just joking. No, you're right. What were you gonna say, Philip?
No, I was gonna say, you know, it William's very right in the fact that, you know, so many people, because I posted both of my stories on a certain website where field researchers of these animals hang out, and a guy in my area got in contact with me, and, you know, he said, well, did you collect hair? Did you get footprints? And, you know, did you get X, Y, and Z? And I said, well, no. And he said, you know, flat out, he told me the first one that happened didn't really happen, you know. The second one that he said, I was mostly mistaken a bear for what I was seeing. You know, and both times, plain as day, I can tell you what I saw, you know, because I didn't have that tangible evidence. I wasn't a good enough source for him, you know.
I'll tell you something, you know, there was an old saying we had when I was in the Army many years ago, and that's, opinions are like assholes. Everyone's got one and they all stink. You know, the guy wasn't there, so how in God's name can he make a claim like that? That's ridiculous.
You know, now that they've got their show on and, you know, they have these people, those people are doing the wrong thing, you know, going out, because they're basically telling everyone that it's okay to go out in the woods and, you know, call for these things and try and lure them to them. You know, they have this whole, again, this whole farcical idea that they're Pooh Bears, you know, that you can pet them and comb them and, you know, sit around the campfire and sing kumbaya.
Well, my friends, those guys have not the slightest idea what they're doing.
No. Then I'll agree 1,000% with you.
Yeah.
But
it'd be nice if they'd actually see one and then give their opinion.
Well, it would be an underwear changing moment, for sure.
Yeah.
Almost fell over.
Oh.
That's my favorite term lately, is an underwear changing moment.
That's a good one. I might have to steal that one from Will. I hope you don't have it copywritten yet.
Did you have any other questions for Philip, Will, at all? I mean, his encounter was awesome. It's probably one of the coolest encounters in
Great group. Information. We sure appreciate you bringing it, talking to us on the show about it.
Yeah, absolutely.
No, I really appreciate you guys for having me on and not calling me crazy and not telling me my story isn't real.
No, a lot of the behaviors sound... a lot of the behaviors sound like a lot of stuff we've heard over and over again.
These behaviors always repeat when they're real events, they do repeat, and we know that. I mean, I've heard so many over, you know, the past 40 years, I can spot a real story from a fake almost instantaneously.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad to know I'm not crazy. Because for the longest time, I thought I was losing my mind. You know, there were about 3 months after the second incident where I was like, did that really happen? You know, did I really see what I think I saw? You know, I've always been intrigued, but did I really see that?
Yeah.
You know, Rene DeHinden used to crack me up. He'd always say that someone, you know, had so-and-so had an incurable mental disease. And when somebody tells you that you didn't see something, but they've never seen anything, to me, that's a mental disease.
Yeah.
That
person has some kind of mental issues that, I don't know what maybe they think they're being intelligent or clever or whatever, but, you know, when the bottom line comes in where the rubber meets the road, they don't know what the hell they're saying.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And that's pretty natural to go through, Philip. I mean, I went through the same thing to where, I mean, you sit there and you go back over your encounter and you're like, God, did that really happen? Did I really see what I saw?
Yourself.
Yeah, you question yourself all the time.
And it's because, you know, we grow up not having that in our, you're not being taught anything like that. It's not in our frame of reference. So, you know, you kind of scratch your head and you say, what the hell, you know, did I really see that? Was that really there? How could that be? I don't know anything about that.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Well, you have to keep in touch with us. Let us know if you see anything else out there.
I most certainly will. I most certainly will.
Ohio is definitely a hotbed.
It is.
It has been. I'm going to definitely, because I'm trying to get more and more into the groups, you know, and everything like that. You know, I just don't want to be associated with certain groups that tell you things don't happen. So,
yeah.
You know,
it's... I
don't blame you.
I have a tendency, as, you know, being younger, of course, I have a tendency to treat everything like it's the Wild West a little bit, you know. But, you know, it's... The thing I like to reassure people the most is, especially if I feel someone's had a real true sighting, that you know, it's okay. You know, if it's a real true sighting, you know, you saw what you saw. I've seen it. You know, I've heard it. You know, it'll. You aren't crazy. Trust me. Join the, we have group. We meet every Wednesday. You know.
My name's awesome. Philip. I've seen a Sasquatch.
Hi, Philip.
Yeah, you know, it's awesome. Therapeutic, all of us that have seen these things, you know, to talk to each other and, you know, compare notes and that. It's very helpful, and almost, I can't think of a case where it hasn't been, where somebody, you know, has told me that it was a huge relief getting it off their shoulders, talking to somebody about it.
I've got
an account a couple days ago that's one of the best that I've ever come across, and I can't really, I'm gonna put it in a new book, and keep the person's identity secret. But and of course they won't come on the show because they're afraid of the ridicule. But it's really an incredible encounter, so I'm looking forward to getting that out to people to read.
Can't wait to read it.
All right,
Philip. Well, listen, we certainly appreciate you coming on.
Awesome, gentlemen. I thank you so much for having me.
Pleasure's ours.
You guys have a great evening.
You too, brother.
Bye-bye.
Take care.
Thanks. You too. Bye-bye.
Thanks for joining us this week, everyone. We appreciate it as usual, and join us again next week.
Have a good night, everyone.